There is nothing like going to a theater, a communal atmosphere, watching something that is bigger than life.
It's dark. You don't look at anybody.
And then the movie started and it was really, really magical.
I went to a movie at 10 in the morning, which to me was so odd. I mean, who goes to a movie at 10? But there was light, there was drama, there was narrative, and I think what I most loved was the way the filmmaker was present, saying, here, take a look at this, think about that.
We were all an 8-year-old boy. We were all a 10-year-old girl. We were all sitting there in that audience watching whatever that movie was.
It became a magical experience. You go into the dark and you learn something new and you come out and it's almost like a religious experience.
If you want a window into what was going on in humankind at a given point in time, you look at movies.
It gave me the sense that I was more than just this little boy. And there was a lot of other things out there that I could do. And if I just kept going in the right direction, maybe the right thing would happen. Because that's what happened in the movies.
Harry, what is it?
Giant Ted Turner has upset a lot of people because of what he's doing to some of Hollywood's greatest old films. Turner recently bought the MGM film library. Now he's adding color to the black and white ones.
To colorize or not to colorize, Ted Turner has said, is his choice.
The last time I checked, they were my films. You know, I'm working on my films.
Let us just say that a very rich man has purchased all the films ever made in Hollywood. He calls together his staff and says, take all the black and white ones and turn them into color using our new computer.
It was a kind of an artist rights issue involving material alteration of films such as colorization, panning and scanning, that sort of thing. It was a big controversy between directors who don't like to see their films changed and studios who were looking to take, say, black and white films and introduce them to a new generation by they thought colorizing them would make them more appealing.
Colorization really was the combustible issue because a lot of film critics, as well as the directors and the cinematographers and our actors, were all so incensed at these changes, especially the possibility of changes to, you know, classic films.
Because the films are a part of our cultural history. And like all accurate representations of who and what we were, I think they deserve preservation in their authentic form.
The committee rooms were packed, and when you get Jimmy Stewart coming, you know, Mr. Smith literally coming to Washington, you know, I was just sitting there sort of admiring the whole scene.
I feel that they're being tampered with, and I want to speak out against this.
The Librarian of Congress got the idea that if film was honored in some way by the national government, that it would be recognized as having cultural and artistic value.
Today, the Congress is taking up a bill called the National Film Preservation Act.
Congress finally stepped in and we were kind of the person brought in to referee if we could.
And that was essentially the creation of the National Film Registry.
The National Film Registry is a list of films of enduring cultural, historical, and aesthetic importance recommended to the Librarian of Congress by a very distinguished board. 25 films are announced each year as being added to that registry.
1989, the first year of the board meeting, was very much focused on the artists' rights issues. And then after that, it seemed very quickly to fade. The issue became preservation and which films should be awarded the seal of the National Film Preservation Board.
This process serves as an invaluable means to advance public awareness of the richness and variety of the American film heritage. This is not simply just another list of great films.
It is saying to America and to the world, these films matter.
What the Film Registry says is, here are great works of art. They were created in a commercial context, but we need to preserve them the way the Metropolitan Museum preserves, you know, Leonardo da Vinci's.
One of the nice things about the National Film Registry is that it's not only preserving our films, but it's also, to a large extent, preserving our cultural heritage and all the things that film capture.
If you look at the advent of movies from the 1890s forward, they were, in many ways, the most important force for shaping a common sense of American culture. There was a time when people in Southern California didn't have much in common with the people in Maine, and the people in Florida had virtually nothing in common with the people in the Pacific Northwest. And it's movies that came along that began to create the sense of nationhood.
The American film was a particular way in which a young nation learned to express itself, express its exuberance, expose its problems, reflect its hopes. It was living history, audiovisual history of the 20th century.
Movies have been the document of our history and culture. They tell us what we looked like, what we wore, what we aspired to, our dreams, the lies we told to one another.
Because in those movies are those little gestures and those little images and the styles and the ways of speaking to each other, the way men spoke to women and women to women and men to men, and the way they projected their own dreams and desires into narratives and fantasies.
That is what the movies does, and it does it better than anything else.
American film really tells us so much about this country. When it starts with storytelling about individuals, underdogs, immigrants, people who don't have something.
I saw that film when I was still in Hong Kong and I was a teenager. I think it gave me a sense of America.
Life can be bright in America.
If you've been fighting America.
Life is bright in America.
If you're all white in America.
The lyrics to that song are really quite sarcastic about being an immigrant in America. That movie was a huge influence on me when I was a teenager. I mean, I probably saw it 5 or 6 times in a row. I was also in love with Natalie Wood. That helped.
You never really understand a person until you consider things from his point of view.
Sir?
Should you climb inside of his skin? Walk around in it.
Gregory Peck was kind of what I thought America was in many kind of respects.
In this country, our courts are the great levelers. In our courts, all men are created equal.
That's the America that my father respected most. In that kind of man that Gregory Peck was always known to play. We identified so strongly with those kids somehow. I was just like instant tears. It still gets me, still makes me cry.
He really portrayed a father who was just so understanding and had such a close relationship with his kids. A lot of people would love to have a father like that. I mean, who wouldn't? I would love to have a father like that. Many of the characteristics that my dad portrayed in that film are really him. Of all the films that he did, it was a film that was closest to his true character, certainly the character he would want to be.
It's a different form of honor than getting an Academy Award. It's a more cumulative or retrospective kind of honor. It's saying your film has stood the test of time.
The Academy Awards preserve the consensus within the industry at the time. Sometimes history proves them right, but very often history proves them wrong.
Most lists exist nowadays for pop culture reasons. It's an excuse for a TV special, it's to sell magazines, it's to get people arguing, and that's what lists do.
The congressional language setting up the registry was done by congressional staff back in 1988, and they used culturally, historically, or aesthetically significant, which we love that phrase because it basically means almost anything. Whoever came up with it, I forget the person's name, the staffer, but I'm forever thankful because it does allow a lot of leverage in terms of the sort of films we're able to pick and put into the registry and preserve.
Because of the 10-year rule, we look at only films that are 10 years old, and that gives us some space and some time.
And I tell you what, from his footprint, he looks like a big fella.
You see something down there, Chief?
No, I just think I'm gonna barf.
Why the 10 years? Why not 50? Why not 5? Why not one that just opened? But I suppose it's to have a little bit of a distance, which is proper. Does the film have a lasting benefit? Does it stand to history?
The idea is that here is an arm of the U.S. government saying that, hey, some films are important. They're part of the picture. So you immediately confer upon them a certain status and dignity.
Each year we do try to fashion an eclectic list, one that is also standalone in its own merits. If we pick 25 famous films one year, or 25 films no one had ever heard of each year, then the list to us would be a lot less useful. The way we pick the National Film Registry each year is that it's a multi-stage process. We start off by soliciting public balloting.
So we take very seriously what the public recommends. They often recommend things that nobody's even heard of.
We tabulate those results and send them to the members of the Film Preservation Board.
Each year, a group of people representing all areas of the industry and education come together and recommend to the Librarian of Congress the films of enduring cultural, historical, aesthetic importance.
People have their personal campaigns, their pet films, their pet causes, and that's as it should be.
Having gone through the obvious choices, Citizen Kane, Citizen Kane, Citizen Kane,
then the less obvious films come up for discussion. And that's where the discussions get interesting.
This was really a good meeting. And I've been on this board since its inception. In the early years, you knew there were certain kinds of movies that were the Sprocket-worn classics, the great films. They would be on the list. And then you put in a couple more that you hoped you would expand people's consciousness about.
It's great to be on the board because there's so many people from different aspects of film and scholarship and everything related to film, and they bring up films, you know, that I always write them down because I go, oh, I haven't seen this, I'll have to go see it.
I'm a fairly new board member in the beginning. It is overwhelming. There are hundreds of films that are talked about. The discussions can range from being very lighthearted to very serious.
So you have people talking about home movies, people talking about newsreels, people talking about short films of various kinds.
And it's always one of the most interesting moments to see what has been chosen. And as you go through, you think, well, of course, that, I can't believe it wasn't chosen before. And then you'll come to something and say, what?
Now it really is American history. Michael Jackson's iconic video, Thriller, was named today to the National Film Registry at the Library of Congress. The first music video ever to receive that honor.
The nice thing about the list is it's all over the place. It's democratic.
You're tearing me apart!
I vote for films that I think are culturally significant, and sometimes I vote for films that I think, even films that I don't particularly like, I will vote for because I think they have a special place in film history.
I certainly felt, as a cultural historian myself, that this was an important part of American culture and that it had to be preserved not simply so that our grandkids could enjoy the same films that we did, but also so that they could understand what America was like at an earlier stage.
Dr. Billington, the librarian, said something very profound a little while ago. He said that stories unite people, theories divide them. So that in itself is a wonderful reason to preserve stories. Stories are profoundly important to human beings.
500 years from now, people will look back and they'll say, this was the beginning. This was the first 100 years. These were the origins. Why didn't they take better care of them? And the day they're talking about is us.
Film is the art form of the 20th century. And we have let it go. The studios stored the films badly, and they deteriorated, they burned. They didn't think of them as an art form.
Half of the movies made before 1950 no longer exist in any form whatsoever. Maybe 80% or so of the silent era is gone.
So much of film history has already been lost, but there's still a very great deal which can be saved if we're willing to do it.
It's really amazing to pick up a roll of film
And just to see this and realize the age of this film and all the people who went into making it, and just to look at the images on it, all these people who worked on these things were all gone now, but they've left behind these amazing shadows for us to enjoy. I always keep a little memento of my beginning here at my desk. This is a Castle Films headline edition, California bound. It's actually a 3-minute clip from the W.C. Fields film, It's a Gift, where they go to this rich man's estate and the family basically has a picnic on the lawn and makes a mess.
Oh, look what you've done.
He ran right in front of the car.
When I first saw W.C. Fields in this film, his humor is sort of laconic behavior and kind of slovenliness, it spoke to me as a man and as a human being.
Oh, you idiot! Those were my mother's feathers!
Never knew your mother had feathers.
Probably the most amazing and unique thing about the Packard campus is that it is part of the Library of Congress. We are fortunate in that we get a part of a budget from Congress every year, and part of that budget, and a fairly good-sized chunk, goes to preservation. In the late 1890s, the nitrocellulose film was developed. The sort of uniqueness of the nitrate film is why they actually have a manager for just the nitrate film collection. So much of the nitrate film collection is unknown, so we're constantly working on the collection to try and identify those little bits of film that might be something really important, but we have no idea what they are. The major problem with nitrate is that it is very flammable. And when I say very flammable, I mean it is very flammable. It is like setting a fuse on a piece of dynamite. We continued using nitrate up until the 1950s when the triacetate safety came out and was deemed just or almost as good as the nitrate film that preceded it. Well, this is my little world here. We call this nitrate land. These are the nitrate vaults of the Library of Congress. We have 124 climate-controlled vaults. They're maintained about 39 degrees Fahrenheit, about 30% relative humidity. Within these vaults, we have 130,000 approximately rolls of nitrate motion picture film dating from about 1894 to about 1952. It is a truly amazing collection and one of a kind. This is our triage area of films that the other staff find that are questionable, and they're brought to me to do inspection on. This is a can, some small fragments. Normally, with a film, you should be able to, like, it should give somewhat and be somewhat loosely wound. This one is solid as a rock. This is what we refer to as a hockey puck. It has been wet. It is probably very stuck together. So I'm going to see if I can at least peel something off to tell what it was. Ah! Oh, darn. Look at that. Wow. Through a variety of reasons, through basic neglect or deterioration especially, many of our early films, and actually some more recent ones, are lost forever. I mean, there's nothing left. I know of one Academy Award-winning film. It's called The Patriot. And all that survives on it are a few trailers and stills. The other reason a lot of them don't survive, of course, is just because the studios didn't really care about them. They were just product, and once they were done and made their money, they went on the shelf. One studio destroyed all their silent negatives in the 40s because they didn't think anyone was ever going to want to see them again.
I got involved in film archiving because I saw Gone with the Wind when I was 12. And to think that I might have a part in somebody, some other 12-year-old girl seeing a movie that changes her life is really exciting to me. I volunteered for the library for a month before I applied for a job. And while I was volunteering, Warner Brothers was doing a restoration of Gone with the Wind. And sure enough, I walked into one of the back rooms one day to find a stack of negatives. And I got really excited, and I remember running into a couple people's office and being like, look at this. And they knew exactly why I was excited because they found their favorite movies and had the same feeling. My favorite part of the job is spending a whole day saving a film. You know, a film that comes in that's torn and no one can watch, and it's up to me to make sure that it gets to a point where it can be rescued. It's kind of like a lost puppy that needs to be taken care of.
Ah, nice.
Nice job. Oh.
Is it a piece of...
Oh, that's great.
So we have a piece of scotch tape that someone just stuck on the film to prepare a rip.
That's my job, and to know that because of me spending hours staring at tiny frames and working with, you know, small pieces of tape, that future generations are going to see it. It's very exciting.
A friend of mine had a 16mm print. He said, you have to see this film. I want you to see this film. It's like, it's an amazing film. No, there were no DVDs in those days, no videotapes, nothing. I had a Bell & Howell projector. I put the film on. I watched it, and I went, oh, my God.
Yay! Hello, Patrick Ball!
What struck me more than anything was the emotion of it. I cried.
Is this the year you came here on? George Bailey, I'll love you till the day I die.
I'm going out exploring someday. You watch.
I cried when Jimmy Stewart grabbed her and they were listening to the phone together and he grabbed her and it was one take. No cutaways. One take. And said,
now you listen to me. I don't want any plastics. I don't want any ground floors. And I don't want to get married ever to anyone. You understand that? I want to do what I want to do. George.
It is my favorite film because it's a film that celebrates the value of life. And there is nothing greater than us all appreciating the value of our lives and other lives.
Film should be an experience. Reality outside the frame is your everyday life. The reality inside the frame is whatever you want to create it to be.
Some films definitely give you access to a dream world. I think musicals probably do that better than most.
I'm a yellow brick road.
Well, the yellow brick road.
It immediately takes you out of reality. It's something that could only happen in your dreams, but that doesn't make it less worthwhile. In fact, for me, it frequently makes it more worthwhile.
It's not a place you can get to by a boat or a train. It's far, far away.
I would watch Wizard of Oz like every day when I was two. I had a really hard time understanding that I couldn't go into the film because it felt so real to me.
It's a wonderful universal story. I mean, if you look at The Wizard of Oz, I mean, it takes a reality, which is the beginning of the movie, and it turns it into a mythology.
Dreams that you dare to dream really do come.
You know, all great storytelling is a form of myth.
Cast your views together three times and think to yourself, there's no place like home.
The Wizard of Oz is still my all-time favorite movie. Probably for the wrong reasons. I never got why Dorothy wanted to go home. Why would she want to go home when she could live with winged monkeys and witches? I don't know. I never understood it. I was sobbing when she went home to that dreary farm.
This was a real, truly live place. And I remember that some of it wasn't very nice, but most of it was beautiful.
I've always been an aficionado of science fiction, fantasy, and horror. The truth is, speculative fiction has always informed us about who we are. If you go back to Invasion of the Body Snatchers, it was a parable about McCarthyism and the Red Scare.
They have to be destroyed, all of them.
They will be, every one of them. We're going to have to search every building, every house in town. Men, women, and children are going to have to be examined. We've got some pointing to do.
Filmmakers were able to make that film and send a message without having it be a message movie.
It's a malignant disease spreading through the whole country.
Initially, those films were relegated to B-movies or even Z-movies. They weren't given any kind of critical acclaim. They generally weren't big commercial successes.
I think I'm not so much a fan of science fiction per se, as I am a fan of cinema that creates worlds, that creates an entire alternate universe that you can escape into for a couple of hours.
The first time that I saw 2001 A Space Odyssey, I was completely blown away. mankind, the future of mankind, even the past, where we came from, where are we going. And the special effects were absolutely magnificent. And it was a film to take seriously, not a film that was disposable.
Open the pod bay doors, Hal.
I'm sorry, Dave. I'm afraid I can't do that.
You could truly lose yourself in that cinematic experience, really opening up a way of looking at reality completely differently. I've always enjoyed films that reward multiple viewings, films that, if you chose to come back and look at them again, you might see something else in them.
It does transport you to an entirely different time and space, and to me it does it so well that I lose myself entirely. I'm in a dream world when I'm watching Blade Runner.
Each frame, each shot is full of the most extraordinary detail. It's really too much to take in on the first viewing, and it requires subsequent viewings to sort of orient yourself in the world of that film and see all of the different layers that went into the fulfillment of that grand design. I think for my generation, there isn't a filmmaker working in Hollywood, certainly, who can deny the influence of the Star Wars films.
The first experience that I had with Star Wars was the summer that it came out. We went to the Cornet Theater in San Francisco, and there was a line, the biggest line I'd ever seen as a kid, around the block. Lights go down, and I didn't really know what to expect whatsoever. Huge musical hit, and the Star Wars logo goes back, and then the scrolling of the text happens, and I began to sort of just become mesmerized. And then the moment that Star Destroyer comes overhead, it just seemed like a forever moment. I just kept watching and watching and watching, thinking this is the biggest spaceship I've ever seen. To top it all off, by the time Darth Vader makes his appearance, people started to boo and started to hiss at Darth Vader. And I just thought, what is going on here? There's something more that this movie in particular has to offer.
It simply opened up a feeling of reality in science fiction. A feeling of a completely thought-through world that existed outside the frame. I think when you look at the history of movies, I don't believe there's been as dominant a cultural milestone in cinema as the first Star Wars film.
Now, as opposed to being on the outside watching, now I sort of feel like I'm part of that now.
Remember, the Force will be with you, always. The world that he created is something you had never seen before, and you just wanted to be with those characters in that world. I was so blown away, but I always felt like I want to do that in animation.
Who goes there? Don't you? Okay, friends. Do you know these life forms?
Yes, they're Andy's toys.
All right, everyone, you're clear to come up. I am Buzz Lightyear. I come in peace.
Oh, I'm so glad you're not a dinosaur.
It's all I ever wanted to do, you know. My true love was cartoons. Even when it was uncool, right? When you're supposed to be into girls or cars or sports or things like that, I would run home after school to watch Bugs Bunny cartoons and always pray that it would be a Chuck Jones cartoon.
Kill the rabbit.
The films that have been the most influential on my career are the films of Walt Disney, Snow White, Pinocchio.
I can walk!
Fantasia.
I think that Fantasia does represent sort of the pinnacle of animation of its time. I was actually just looking at Night on Bald Mountain the other day because there's beautiful, beautiful fire animation. Animating fire is not easy, and I don't even know how the animators did it.
In animation, you can do anything. And then the first time you see something that you drew come to life, you are addicted because it's like magic.
When you see something that you drew move, that is a mind-blowing experience. I remember when I was 12 or 13 and I saw my first Super 8 animation move, and it was like, I want to say it's better than sex, but I never had sex when I was 12, right? But it was just incredible.
We knew we were making the first computer animated feature film.
but the main focus was the story and the characters. Walt Disney always said, for every laugh, there should be a tear. And it's something that is so important to me in my filmmaking, is that heart. Because I believe that's something that stays with an audience much longer than the jokes have gotten old, but that heart will always stay there. You know how you feel when you first watch these movies, and it brings a tear to your eye.
Absolutely, animation belongs on any list of culturally significant works. Animation is art.
When one looks through the list of films that have been selected over time, what one is struck by, most of all, is the extraordinary diversity of the kinds of movies.
It isn't just Hollywood films. It's films that document America's life and America's heritage. There's a wonderful film that was named to the registry a few years ago. It's a piece of amateur filmmaking made by the wife of a doctor in a sort of agricultural town in Minnesota in the 30s, and she went around photographing what the place looked like. Well, this is wonderful. It's like watching a bunch of live Edward Hopper and Charles Sheeler canvases come to life, you know, and who knew? And so there's a film that very specifically preserves a niche in a corner of American life.
There is some sense of sadness and poignancy. It's part of our history. It's part of our family history. It's a history of a people, history of our country.
One of the most tragic yet fascinating moments in our country's history was the mass internment of 120,000 Japanese Americans.
Overnight, American citizens of Japanese ancestry were looked at with fear and suspicion simply because we looked like the people who bombed Pearl Harbor.
Mass hysteria took over the country, and President Roosevelt ordered 120,000 people taken from their homes, moved within 3 days, and put in internment camps throughout the country.
I still remember that day when two American soldiers with bayonets on their rifle came stomping up to the front door of that house and ordered our family out. And I remember my mother had tears streaming down her cheek as we moved out. It became normal for me to begin the school day in a black tar paper barrack with the Pledge of Allegiance to the flag. I could see the barbed wire fence and the sentry towers right outside my schoolhouse window as I recited the words, "With liberty and justice for all."
I have a 9-year-old daughter, and I want her to be able to experience and see what these camps look like. I think when you talk about the history of an experience, you can't really feel it unless you can see it and visualize it.
My father is Dave Masaharu Tatsuno, and he was responsible for the film Topaz, which documents life in an internment camp during World War II. That's my mother holding me in the desert. It wasn't meant to be a documentary. He was just trying to do a family film for us.
What has come to be known as his film was really just a portrayal of life in the camps, of the daily struggles that people experience, and it captured for all time something that America didn't want anyone to see.
Home movies are so important. They show our history, of our family, of our community, of our country. That's important. That's very important.
The addition of the Zapruder film, the home movie that captured the assassination of John Kennedy, demonstrates, I think, at its farthest extent, that America's film heritage, its movie heritage, embraces much, much more than just the Hollywood feature film.
I think this film is real, and it happened during my lifetime. I saw it. It's ugly, it's sudden, it's shocking, and it's inexplicable. And the only way that you can recreate the experience of it is showing it.
Getting away with it these days. The cops in the yards will take care of you.
Oh, wait a minute.
You wouldn't throw us off the train, would you?
Yeah, and you're going to get 30 days for it.
In jail?
Yes, in jail.
Now, why don't we sit down and talk this thing over?
Almost always, the things that people wanted to cut out of movies were ideas. And so you have ideas being cut out of the original Babyface by the New York censors.
Babyface was really interesting because I'd known the film for a long time, and actually I had a copy of it on Laserdisc, for those who remember what Laserdiscs were. They asked me to go and check the negative to see how, you know, what condition was in, and that's when I noticed that we actually had two negatives. So I get them out, and I start looking at the two real ones, and I notice that there's something strange about them. So I put the two real ones down on a table and set one on top of the other one. And that's when I noticed that, you know, like the one real one was this big and the other real one was like this big. And I'm like, this is something going on here.
Say, I like it here. How about a job?
Now don't tell me this great big building. There ain't someplace for me.
Have you had any experience?
Plenty.
And I started going through the two negatives and also listening to the soundtracks and began finding these great differences between the two films.
And then he has the eureka moment, and he realizes that what he has is the film before it was edited. That the 5 minutes of Barbara Stanwyck going to the city to use what she has, you know, to get what she wants, is in there. And they thought it was lost.
The boss won't be back for an hour.
Well, then why don't we go in and talk this over?
Negative was cut to the censorship version. The duplicate negative was the original pre-censored version that had all the naughty bits still in it. And that was just the find of a lifetime.
Look, here. Nietzsche says, all life, no matter how we idealize it, is nothing more nor less than exploitation. That's what I'm telling you. Exploit yourself. Go to some big city where you will find opportunities. Use men. Be strong. Defiant. Use men to get the things you want.
The version that was discovered puts some of the sex back, but it puts a lot of the philosophy back.
Yeah.
The New York censors altered the sharpness of the philosophical thrust for the release version because they were afraid that it would offend people.
What chance has a woman got?
More chance than men. A woman, young, beautiful like you are, could get anything she wants in the world. But there is a right and a wrong way. Remember, the price of the wrong way is too great. Go to some big city where you will find opportunities. Don't let people mislead you. You must be a master, not a slave. Be clean, be strong, defiant, and you will be a success.
So you always hear about these things, but they never survive.
Yeah.
And to this day, I don't think we've found out exactly why this negative survives and why, on this particular film, they actually made this duplicate negative before they cut the film.
You can make a movie, by the way, that endorses conventional morality. That's not the problem. The problem is that it was not sincere. It's not real. And in the case of Babyface, when it really said what it wanted to say, of course, it's better. That is why censorship is so horrible. Because censorship blocks the free expression of an era talking to another era.
For the most part, most films that are made are entertainment, and that's all they're meant to be. And I think there's an unfortunate sense people have that all films are just films.
Well, I think the shining example of something that is a folk fantasy and commercial and art is probably Godfather.
They used to live in Bayside, Queens, and there's a local theater there, Arcade O'Keefe's, which was an old kind of ornate theater that had the skylights and the stars and had the balcony, and that's where I had first seen The Godfather played in that theater. And it played great, it sounded great, it looked great.
Now you come to me and you say, Don Corleone, and give me justice. But you don't ask for respect. You don't offer friendship. You don't even think to call me Godfather.
Somehow, with the performances of all the actors, especially Brando, hit that neural chord that we all have, and there was a visceral reaction from almost anyone who saw it.
The cinematographer on The Godfather, Gordon Willis, one of the great cinematographers of our time, did a very, very daring thing when he photographed those pictures.
Gordon decided that he didn't want people messing about with his image, and he shot it in a way that you couldn't print it in any other way than the way that he shot it. You can get the color wrong, you can make skin green if you want to, but it's got to be printed dark.
I'm glad you came, Mike. I hope we can straighten everything out.
The original negatives of Godfather 1 and Godfather 2 were not in good condition, were not capable of making new copies, and that they really needed a restoration.
The negative of that film was in tatters. And this is The Godfather. This is The Godfather. This is a film, you know, I think people consider, if not maybe the greatest film of all time, one of them.
A lot of prints were made from that original negative, more so than probably should have been made. Negative sustained some injury, as any negative that gets overused will.
The more popular the film, the worse condition the original negative is going to be in. It's been loved to death.
It's not until the past 15, maybe as far as 20 years, that the studios have realized what they have stacked away in their vaults. They really didn't realize that these golden treasures that they had in their vaults, and hence, they weren't looked after very well. The beauty of this job is that once you start working on these films and you start getting to explore them scene by scene, shot by shot, frame by frame, is that you get to see little things, little nuances, little pieces of the puzzle, and your appreciation for the film just explodes.
We're not creating anything. What we're doing is to try and take what people made and just preserve it and make it look like what it was supposed to look like. The trick is not to change it.
The thing about movies, it's about storytelling. And the story that it tells still today stands up very strong.
At first, you think, oh, God, this is going to be the same 20 movies. We're going to have one here, Casablanca. We're going to have the obvious ones, right? You do have them. But then you have some that are surprising.
I said, relax and don't say anything. I just want to talk about a film which I'm sure has never been brought up at the board.
How'd you do, I? See, you've met my faithful hand in hand.
People are going to say, you must be crazy. The film's lacking in taste. It's this, it's that. But at the same time, here's a film that's played at midnight in theaters across the country for 30 years. There's a reason why the Rocky Horror Show is a popular film. Well, if it's that popular, it must be speaking somehow to this country. There must be something woven into what makes that film work. And I have to sympathize with Dr. Billington because he has to go to the halls of Congress and tell everyone. One of the 25 films is the Rocky Horror Show. It's this great film. It's about transvestites and men from Mars and dancing hunchbacks. I don't know how he does it.
Well, they did certainly widen my horizon.
Put your hands on your hips.
Honestly, when you're dealing with a wide variety, you have to be open to a wide variety.
Rocky Horror Picture Show is the most successful midnight movie ever, way more than Pink Flamingos ever was.
I'll tell you a story about it. A woman came up to me and she said, I saw you sitting here and I just had to tell you that Spinal Tap saved my life. No, I'm not going to tell that story. No, it was the Princess Bride that saved her life. So Spinal Tap didn't save her life at all. It was Princess Bride that saved her life. And I don't think that's on the registry, but it should be. We first showed it in a preview in Dallas. The people came up to me and said, why would you make a movie about a band that nobody's heard of? And a band that's so bad? Why don't you make a movie about the Rolling Stones? So it took a while for people to catch up to it. Once they did, it became this kind of iconic representation of the world of rock and roll.
What we do is if we need that extra push over the cliff, you know what we do?
Put it up to 11.
11, exactly.
I love this, a Spinal Tap. It takes the things that are
naturally humorous about that lifestyle and exaggerates them.
One louder. Why don't you just make 10 louder and make 10 be the top number and make that a little louder?
These go to 11.
I never would have heard of this. A very early sound film demonstration, which is a quacking duck.
One can look at Gus Visser and you can think, what is the aesthetic value? That might be hard to justify. It's there because it demonstrates an important breakthrough in the technology of the history of motion pictures.
It was brought to our attention and we watched it and said, we have to have this. It's a sound film demonstration and it's hysterical. It's a film you can't really describe how he makes the duck quack.
I will say that when I was looking at the movies that are on the National Film Registry, I was pleasantly surprised that Blazing Saddles was on there.
Blazing Saddles was basically nominated by a reporter who has done a lot of articles on the registry and preservation.
Blazing Saddles has a special place in my heart. I love the myth of the American West. I like cowboys. I like cowboy stories. I like cowboy poetry. I like Roy Rogers. I like Dances with Wolves. Hey! That myth of the American West is the myth of America. But Blazing Saddles takes that myth and twists it and turns it on its head. It also takes the movie-making myth and twists it and turns it on its head.
Raising it!
And finally, the board said, well, he may have a point.
And the rest is history.
To see Blazing Saddles on there was a little bit of vindication for me that I didn't waste my time in college watching that movie so many times. I wasn't wasting my time. I was enriching myself with film history.
Now, look, all I'm trying to say is that there are lots of things that a man can do, and in society's eyes, it's all hunky-dory. A woman does the same thing, the same, mind you, and she's an outcast.
Finished?
No.
One of the most important things that I can do with my role on the board is to keep the contribution of women to film history in the center of our discussions.
We had to write reports on what we wanted to be, and the boy next to me wrote a composition on how he was going to be a movie director. And I got so angry at him, because movies seem too good for us, like they came from magical people in Hollywood, and here he was, the guy that cheated off me during the tests, and how could he be a movie director? And then I thought, well, I must be this angry because that's what really what I want to do.
Fast Times at Richmond High is one of my favorite films. Not the favorite, you know, but when Sean Penn ordered the pizza into the classroom.
What, the double cheese and sausage? Right here, dude.
I thought this was the best moment in American film history, actually.
Very few people know about the extent of the involvement of women in early film culture in the United States. Half of all films in the silent era were written by women. All of the top screenwriters were women. The highest paid screenwriters were all women. And many of the top directors were women. It was a growing industry. It was the popular mass medium. People were going to the film every single day. So there were incredible opportunities for women in Hollywood. Lois Weber is an extraordinary figure in American film history, and she's somebody who very few people know about. Everybody's heard of D.W. Griffith, everybody's heard of Cecil B. DeMille, and in the 1910s, Weber was often mentioned alongside Griffith and DeMille as the three great minds of filmmaking. She was Universal's top director, and she was a top director who made socially engaged films about the key problems of the day. The film that's in the film registry, Where Are My Children, is a film about birth control and abortion, and it was Universal's top moneymaker of 1916. It traveled all around the world. Not only did she make these films about really difficult issues that we're still grappling with as a culture, she made popular box office successes. When you start looking at the studio era, the 30s and 40s and beyond, then you really do see gender bias. Then it really becomes nearly impossible for women to direct. When I was in graduate school at USC Cinema, a group of us organized a small screening series called Films by Great Women Directors, and somebody wrote across the sign, "There are none." Often when you're working with the studios, they'll give you a list of pre-approved directors, and you'll find that there are very few, if in many cases, no women directors on the list. Dorothy Arzner is the only woman to work as a director in the studio era in the 30s and 40s. That's an extraordinary accomplishment.
She always joked that she was one of the guys. She used to dress like a man. She used to hang around with the guys. She used to behave like the guys. She always said, that's how I got on in the industry, because I was just one of the guys. They didn't think about me as being a woman. I was just a guy directing films.
Dance Girl Dance is a film that takes on, in an allegorical way, Hollywood's representation of women. It's about a dancer who aspires to be a serious ballet dancer. She's sort of stuck as the comic act amidst all this sexual exploitation of women. And the climax of the film occurs when she stops in the middle of her performance. And looks straight at the audience, which means she looks straight at the camera, and she says,
I know you want me to tear my clothes off so you can look your 50 cents worth. 50 cents for the privilege of staring at a girl the way your wives won't let you. I'm sure they see through you just like we do.
It's an extraordinary moment in which we as the audience are confronted and asked to think about what we routinely see in movies, which is the sexual objectification of women. Weber and Arzner were very different women who made very different kinds of films in very different contexts. But if I think about it, what maybe unites them is that they had a unique and singular vision of what they could do that just allowed them to persevere. It's really important to have female filmmakers because women have a different perspective on the world, on our culture, on life.
Women filmmakers, we have an awful lot to bring to the screen. There are not a whole lot of us, and we have this nurturing quality, and we have often a different point of view, a way of seeing the world, a different way of placing characters or placing the camera. So let's play around with that. Let's experiment. And that's, and I did that with Daughters of the Dust. And for a lot of people, it worked, and for a lot of people, they said, whoa, what is this? What are you doing? And it was like, I'm exploring, and I'm telling a story my way.
I was involved in getting Back to the Future put on the film registry. I went to the fans. Back to the Future is one of my favorite movies. I had used a wonderful website, BTTF.com, that was hosted by a man named Stephen Clark. And I wrote to him and said, look, fan response is an incredible factor in getting something on the registry, and make your fans write in. And the response was amazing. Steve Leggett, who works with the film registry, said that he had so many emails every day, hundreds of emails coming in, and it was the first time that there had been such an overwhelming response to getting one film on from people outside of the Library of Congress. It's found its way into the popular culture so much, and the fact that you can now buy a flex capacitor online and people will buy them is saying something about the impact of the movie.
My moment of triumph, as far as the National Film Registry is concerned, I had a couple of different ones that I put on there. The one film that I actually got chosen is a little film called
Let's All Go to the Lobby, Let's All Go to the Lobby, Let's All Go to the Lobby to get ourselves.
A little film made by the Filmac Company up in Chicago, and it's a bumper that goes in between the movies to get you to go to the candy counter.
The sparkling drinks are just dandy, the chocolate bars and the candy, so let's all go to the lobby. Da, 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 da.
But I looked at it and I was like, this is such an important little piece of film. Everybody knows it. Everybody's seen it. It's a perfect example of this kind of cinematic advertising that they were doing. And it's fun. So I put it in, and sure enough, it got chosen that year. I was totally blown away.
Let's all go to the lobby to get ourselves a treat.
Thank you, thank you.
When I was younger, I was interested in films about power. People with invincible skills. They could shoot a gun out of someone's hand. They could snap a bullwhip around your neck.
This will remind you that I've been here once and can return.
And so from around 6 to 10, those were the staple of my imagination, and you'd leave the movie and you'd be acting out all the parts with your friends. As a matter of fact, in the first Western I ever did, I ruined my first take on horseback where I'm shooting somebody with my pistol, because on the finished film you can see me looking at the guy steely-eyed and pulling the trigger and going, really stupid. But, you know, it shows you the grip that these things have on you.
When I was little, that's all I used to think about, the NBA.
There's nothing more powerful than a true story, because it makes you feel like you don't have that escape valve that I have when I watch fiction. When it gets too tough or too close or too emotional, I can always kind of back out of it just a little bit by saying, this isn't true. And when you're seeing a powerful documentary and you believe what you're seeing, you don't have that, and that's a good thing.
My mother seems like mother and father to me. She won't be really hanging around over here that much because of the gangs.
I always wanted to make stories. This was a chance, an opportunity to hopefully tell a great story, but a story that was true, and a story that, in focusing on these two kids and their families, what their lives had to say about the American dream, about race in America, about poverty in America, is something I think that needed to be said and needs to always be said, and unfortunately continues to need to be said. I would say an influence for me early on was Barbara Kopple's work, in particular Harlan County.
Come all ye young pillars, brave and sublime, seek not your fortune lay down in mine.
The beauty of documentaries is it only happens once. It can't happen another time. I remember when I was with the widows from the Farmington mine disaster in Harlan County. They had never gotten together to speak about it, what it meant to lose their husbands. This was the first time, and they sat in a circle and they talked about the most intimate details of their husbands, of their lives, of what it meant to be a coal miner, what it meant to work in one of the most dangerous industries in this country. And one or two of them just burst into tears. Another one got really angry.
I live right on, almost on the seat of the main explosion, right, sir? And they said, you get out of your house. And the police told me to get out. But you know why? Because they didn't want me to see what was going on up that damn dirty, filthy mines.
It's about communication. It's about connection. It's about stepping into somebody's world that you would never be privy to, and being able to be there and understand what's going on with them and who they are and what they're about. I mean, nothing could be finer than that, and nothing else will do that. And if we don't save those films and preserve those films, we won't have a history.
Film reconnects us to the world and to our experience of our lives in this space, in this time. It is a short film about water, where the filmmaker starts from a distance and looks at water. There are little trickles of water, little waterfalls, streams with the rocks visible, and he moves ever closer to the water and the light playing on water to the degree that you no longer recognize it as water. Then I guarantee once you see this film, you never look at water the same way again. It's not meant to make sense. It's not meant to tell a story, but in many ways it's meant to touch us the way poetry does. It is not always easy to engage the experimental film. And one has to simply open oneself to the language of film. That's where the beauty lies. We, through the medium, we see the world anew.
You know, the great thing about the registry is that it's grown to be pretty diverse. It's gotten a lot more inclusive. You know, there's a lot of experimental, avant-garde, and independent films. There's lots of documentary films. There's home movies. There even are a few industrial and educational films.
There was a turtle by the name of Bert, and Bert the turtle was very alert. When danger threatened him, he never got hurt. He knew just what to do. He's got
This country has always been about persuasion. Really, most societies are. And these films really illuminate that, kind of the changing history of what we were told.
We must be ready every day, all the time, to do the right thing if the atomic bomb explodes. Doc and Color, this family knows what to do, just as your own family should.
Across the Middle is a goofy and rather marvelous film made in about 1953-54 by, let me see if I can get it right, the National Cleanup, Paint-Up, Fix-Up Committee in association with the Federal Civil Defense Administration. And it puts forth a really, really odd message.
Three identical miniature frame houses, the house on the right, an eyesore. But you've seen these same conditions in your own hometown. This house is the product of years of neglect. It has not been painted regularly. The house in the middle, in good condition, with a clean, unlittered yard.
What it says is this: if your house is freshly painted and clean and doesn't have a lot of crap sitting around in the front yard, you're a lot more likely to survive a nuclear attack. So it really makes kind of, you know, a moral argument, a behavioral argument for surviving nuclear attack.
Two houses are a total loss, but the well-kept and painted house in the middle still stands.
Of course, it's funded by the paint industry, so they're trying to sell house paint and saying, hey, it's going to help you survive nuclear attack. I mean, this is, you know, this is a little weird.
The dingy house on the left, the dirty and littered house on the right, or the clean white house in the middle. It is your choice. The reward may be survival.
Every movie that is popular, every movie that is popular captures something of the ideas that were alive at the time. And very often, the ideas that they capture and that make them so acceptable to the public are lies.
This is D.W. Griffith's film that essentially Griffith, right then and there, invented a lot of the grammar of film. Its aesthetic and historical significance from the point of view of film is beyond debate. Its value as a portrayal of American history is not at all beyond debate. It is basically a pro-Ku Klux Klan view of what happened in the South.
I think The Birth of a Nation really legitimized the motion picture industry. It was the first film to be shown at legitimate Broadway theaters. I think for the first time, people realized almost not only the power of the motion picture, but also almost the danger of the motion picture, what it could accomplish.
Unfortunately, all of these innovative ideas were used to advance the notion of segregation, Jim Crow, racism, racial bias. It was a dangerous film, and it caused a lot of personal harm to people after it came out during that time.
Birth of a Nation was propaganda, you know, and it was slander. But it's important to recognize, I think by ignoring it or by denying, you know, the existence of Birth of a Nation, one was losing a piece of cinema history.
So we'll find them in the end, I promise you. We'll find them. Just as sure as the turning of the earth.
I know that the generation of people that saw The Searchers when they were young will never forget it. It was essentially about a man, played by John Wayne, who comes to save a little girl who has been kidnapped by an Indian tribe.
It's always the menacing music, the menacing war paint that was assigned to these characters.
Let's go!
Growing up, if you look back at all the cowboy and Indian stuff I watched as a kid, why were we the heroes? I didn't quite get that. It took me a long time to realize that, even when you played cowboys and Indians with your friends. Today, I'd want to be the Indian. They're the rebels. And I would be for the Indians against the cowboys.
I saw The Searchers with American Indian. And I was unaware of the racism in the film until I was sitting next to her, and she just stormed out at a certain scene in the movie. And I went out and followed her, and I said, what's going on? She says, but did you see the movie? I said, yeah, I saw it. But did you see what happened?
These are my people. Winch Mayo, go. Go, Martin, please.
Stand aside, Martin.
So he was searching for her so he could kill her. So she would have to live with them. Because she was living a fate worse than death. It was very disturbing.
Ethan, no, you don't! Stand aside.
I thought that was really something that I really wouldn't want my daughter to look at. It really helped create a persona about Indian people that continues to this day.
The Exiles was made about Native Americans living in Los Angeles in the 1950s. In other words, Native Americans not out in the desert or in the mountains in the kind of environment that most people in cliché terms think of, but trying to survive in a brutal urban environment.
The Exiles really put kind of a face on Indian people at the time. During that time period, it was either relocation or maybe the serving in the armed services, where a lot of Indian people left the reservations and came to cities and met other Indian people. It showed kind of the truth of living in an urban area as far as the isolation depicted in the young woman. She always seemed to be alone and longing for a better life. Film very much is important in depiction of a people.
Fighting each other for
the punk. Hood is a document of its time. It's a document of what was going on in that time period.
You have to think, young brother, about your future.
It gave a voice to the voiceless.
Listen, I want to do something in my life, all right? I want to be somebody.
The film, for me, it's like my diary. It was a cathartic thing for me to show where I was from and where I'd gone through. Film is a reflection of the times of which we live in, good or bad. I was responsible for pushing forward Birth of a Nation into the Film Preservation Board. That movie led to the deaths of many, many black people through lynching, through enacting laws, segregation, and through Jim Crow and everything. But it really shows the power of film and for evil as well as good.
When you watch a movie from the past, you're involved in a dialogue between past and present. There's what's up on the screen, and then there's the person looking at it. And every person who looks at it brings their own history and finds their own value in it.
Look at every war that we've been through, and whether it's a war that we won, like, you know, the good war, the World War II, the war we lost, like Vietnam, a war like that's going on now in Iraq and Afghanistan, where we don't know what the result is going to be. The result is the same on the people who fought it, and I think that's important for people to understand.
Best Years of Our Lives is about three GIs returning from service to their hometown. I enlisted in the Army Air Corps. I was a bombardier in a B-17. I was no hero, but I was there, I did the job. Naturally, it hit me particularly hard when Dana Andrews, playing the bombardier, goes out to a field where they're cocooning old B-17 bombers. And he approaches one and climbs back up into it. And the sound comes up. And the filmmaking makes him experience a bombing raid. And the sound is extraordinary. That had a particular meaning for anybody who was in a bomber.
Hey, you! What are you doing in that airplane?
It had a great effect on me. The movies create order out of the chaos of our lives, and that's what this was.
I was the last person that I ever would have thought would have gone to war. War scared me when I was young.
After I came back from Vietnam, I gave away my uniforms. I really put the whole thing behind me. I just shut the door and move on with my life. I don't guess I spoke with another veteran or about my experience for 8 or 9 years. By chance, I was put in touch with a guy who worked with veterans, and he invited me to a screening of The Deer Hunter. Really discovered that the issues that they were dealing with in that film, how frightened those guys were once they got over there. They went over there with such enthusiasm and such honest, sincere patriotism and discovered themselves just in this chaotic world. That really, to me, emotionally hit home, how that stays with you once you've been through that. It's like something that a human shouldn't have to experience. That loss of control, that having to give up on life because you don't know that you're going to be alive in an hour, in a day, and it's just something that doesn't go away. It's a good thing that films like Deer Hunter were made because it's an honest representation of the emotion of war. And I think people need to know that. We should not go to war easily because the impact on people's lives is permanent.
Film captured me as it does so many people when I was a kid. As a child, there were no good movies or bad movies, there were just movies.
I grew up in a very poor family, and I think going to the movie theater, the old walk-in theater that cost maybe 20 cents, it was the window to the world. It largely took me out of my own life.
So for a dime, I could go and stay there all day and watch 3 pictures and Pathé News and Mickey Mouse. So my outlet was to watch film, any film. And I did. I love them all, and I still do today.
I just loved the glamour of life in film from the 30s and 40s. Like, I wanted to have all those glittering costumes, and I wanted Cary Grant to take me out to dinner. But the closest thing I have is film.
This is an art. It's not just how to make money. It's not just what we can sell it as, but it's something valuable that we should save.
This is part of who we are as a culture, and we need to preserve it. It's not a matter of, like, should we? It's how are we going to?
We've got a job to preserve the aspirations and the images and ideals and dreams of millions and millions of people. I think one thing we can say is that 500 or 1,000 years from now, when people want to know what life was like, they will go to movies, they will go to the moving image materials that we created first, because those are the time capsules of our era.
They are now being preserved and restored so that when we're all long gone, as long as there's something to watch films with, they'll be able to see these.
The beauty of film is that it's everybody's. It's not just the socially elite, it's everybody's.
Somebody says, why would you save movies? Well, I'd ask those people back, why do you save your family pictures?
As a society, we want to do the same thing. We want to say, who were we? Where are we now? And what do we want people in the future to think about us? It's our family album.
Absolutely imperative that we save the art form of the 20th century. And how can we not?
He's looking at you, kid.
Let's all go to the lobby. Let's all go to the lobby to get ourselves a treat.
Delicious things to eat.
The popcorn can't be beat. The sparkling drinks are just dandy. The chocolate bars and the candy. So let's all go to the lobby to get ourselves a treat. Let's all go to the lobby.